It's homecoming weekend in Lincoln, Nebraska. Matthew Hansen has brought a friend to his family's tailgate party. Matt is from the little town of Red Cloud. Farhad Pekar was born in Afghanistan, 6,000 miles away. Matthew met Farhad when he went to Kabul in 2005 on assignment for the Lincoln Journal Star with photographer Dior Asqui. They arrived in Kabul during the religious holiday of Ramadan, but it looked like the Wild West as Matt pointed his video camera out the window.
You know, there's no traffic laws, there's no crosswalks. It's basically like that video game of Frogger where you're like gonna have to try and get across the street without getting run over.
In the past three decades, Kabul had become a refugee center of 4 million people, struggling to survive after the Russian occupation, the Afghan civil war, the Taliban, and the U.S. invasion that followed 9/11.
Just destroyed buildings on your right and left, and you know, stray dogs and women in the full blue burqa begging along the side of the road.
At 4:30 the next morning, they woke to the sound of the Muslim call to prayer coming from loudspeakers all over the city.
You're hearing it in stereo. It's just like it's coming from all angles, right, all over.
It was a peaceful beginning to what was about to become a difficult day. At the military training center in Kabul, they watched as the Nebraska National Guard helped train the Afghan National Army. And slowly they realized their interpreter didn't speak English.
And Matthew completely lost it. That was when he got like the most stressed I had seen him so far, because he was like, what am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? This guy doesn't speak English. You know, how are we gonna function?
After a night of frantic phone calls, Matthew found Farhad Pekar, an Afghan journalist who already had a full-time job.
I think he could sense the desperation in my voice, so he agreed to come the next day.
You can't say when you become friends with people. Just become friends because you like each other. There are a lot of, you see, things that you have in common, you have the same ideas.
You know, he really kind of started becoming a part of our project. He was like a part of our team and was really invested in what we were gonna do each day.
Farhad took them to a school that was little more than a series of tents surrounding a well. Under the Taliban, girls had not been allowed to attend school at all. Now they were learning their lessons from teachers dressed in fashionable veils and wearing lipstick. Once they left the school, the women's faces vanished behind blue burqas. To me, Dior wrote in her nightly blog, it seems like a personal jail woven out of fabric.
To say that this is a male-dominated society is an understatement. I even remember mentioning to Matthew and Farhad that I was discouraged that so many of my photos are of men. Farhad responded by pointing out that my photos would document how things are in Afghanistan, and here, women are rarely seen.
In 2005, the reign of the Taliban seemed to be over. Hope lived side by side with the ghosts of the past.
In western Kabul, children fly kites right next to a graveyard filled with the civilian casualties of the recent civil war. I talked to a family who fled after the first few nights of fighting in 1992. They didn't see their house for a decade. When they returned, the furniture was gone. So was the roof and the walls. We interviewed a mullah at his mosque. He told us he was jailed and tortured by the communists because they believed he was too Muslim, and then jailed and tortured by the Taliban because they believed he wasn't Muslim enough. He takes special pride in having outlasted both groups.
Matthew and Dior were on their way to interview the Afghan Minister of Mines when they walked straight into the middle of an anti-government demonstration.
They knew that they are taking risks. We were driving and walking on the streets that every minute a bomb could go off.
Farhad was calm the whole time. Farhad was never worried. And right about that time, we went out the back way.
We left on foot, armed only with some heavy camera gear and Farhad's silver tongue.
Farhad had negotiated their way to the interview and got them out safely. Now, after 3 weeks in Afghanistan, it was time to say goodbye.
I didn't really understand why somebody could love that country so much. And here I was. It was like the last day, and I did not want to leave. I did not want to leave. I really was not ready to leave.
In November 2005, they returned to Lincoln and began work on a four-part series for the Lincoln Journal Star. It featured a story about a young Afghan named Farhad Pikar.
For some unknown reason, I was born middle class in Nebraska, a place where heartache means a losing Husker football season. For some unknown reason, he was born 2 years before me in Afghanistan. And it just seems dead wrong that the American dream, or whatever's left of it, is reserved only for those of us with the dumb luck to be born in Red Cloud instead of Kabul. So I sit here before you stunned at the randomness of the lives we lead.
But every time I see something that happens there, I always think of Farhad. I always think of things through his eyes now.
Dior and Matthew will always remain to be my teachers. We live in this world, and if we want to live in peace, we need to accept each other.
Go to our website at netnebraska.org/NebraskaStories.